As we've mentioned before, the Conservative Party have been having one hell of a terrible week or past couple of weeks with Partygate, with an upcoming or currently happening cost of living crisis that's happening at the moment, massive inflation, just general terrible infrastructure problems that they've been having, and unable to cope with their current situation because of the 10 years of austerity that they've been maintaining for the past, you know, like obviously the past decade. What we have here, of course, because of Partygate, because of like record low approval ratings, record low polling from the Conservatives, we know that they need a scapegoat. So Nadine Dorries, the current Conservative Culture Secretary, decided to break the ministerial code in order to do this and give a story to the tabloids about her plans for the BBC. And we've got this on the BBC article as well. She broke ministerial code because she talked about this in an interview to tabloids as opposed to actually breaking the story in Parliament, which is against the ministerial code. And today, the Monday, at time of recording this live stream, she got told off by the House Speaker for doing that. It just kind of proves how slapdash this announcement was and how desperate they were to have a scapegoat for the current situation, and the BBC is their scapegoat. But let's talk about what's going to be happening, because I know a lot of people who follow me outside of the UK are wondering what's going on. So for those of you who don't know, the BBC is basically funded by something called the license fee, where it's about 40 pence a day, where you'll get numerous TV channels, radio, CBB, CBBC, BBC Music introducing and things like that. Basically a massive swathe of content. You get BBC News as well, BBC Sport, all of these massive divisions, and the whole world, like the whole worldwide impact and reach of an organization like the BBC, which is celebrating its centenary today. However, the license fee over the past few years has not been keeping up with inflation, and this is the main reason why the BBC has had so many cuts over the past few years, especially like during a decade of Tory austerity. And the goal would be, because of the rising inflation costs, that the BBC, the license fee amount, would be increased in order to like keep pace with inflation, but the government are in charge of how much the BBC gets. And our current Conservative governments are vehemently anti-free speech, they're anti-free press and things like that, so they want the BBC to go. And also, let's not forget that in the UK, Rupert Murdoch, who is like the in charge of the Sun newspaper and Fox News in America, he sees the BBC as like his biggest competitor, which is why he wants the BBC completely taken down, essentially get rid of the main competition. So yeah, BBC license fee to be frozen at £159 for 2 years, the government confirms. Culture Secretary Nadine Dorries has confirmed the BBC license fee is to be frozen at £159 for 2 years. This is the yearly cost. Speaking in the House of Commons on Monday, Ms. Story says the government could not justify extra pressure on the wallets of hard-working households. Following the two-year freeze, she said the fee will rise in line with inflation for the following 4 years. Director General Tim Davies says the freeze would mean tougher choices which will impact licence fee payers. The licence fee pays for BBC services including TV, radio, the BBC website, podcasts, iPlayer and apps. Its existence is guaranteed at least until the 31st of December 2027 by the BBC's Royal Charter, which sets out its funding and purpose. Ms. Dorries says that the BBC must support people at a time where their finances are strained, making savings and efficiencies, and use the billions in public funding it receives to deliver for viewers, listeners and users. In a joint statement, Mr. Davey and BBC Chairman Richard Sharp said the settlement would mean the BBC will have to absorb inflation. And the cost, I think, calculated was that it would have to make like £2 billion in savings over the next few years. They noted the corporation's income for UK services is already 30% lower in real terms than it was 10 years ago. So what's interesting is that the BBC over the past few years, specifically their news division, we'll talk about like general aspects later on in terms of the broader swathe of like the BBC as a massive organization that it is. Like it is kind of a monolith in terms of branding, but there's so many subdivisions to it. But specifically, BBC News has done everything in its power to ensure that this current government got elected at the last election, like printing just outright fabricated news stories about the opposition, allowing people like Nigel Farage and Boris Johnson to have platforms completely uncontested, or when they refused to turn up for interviews, just let it happen. Who was the was it Andrew Neil who famously like has interviews on the BBC with both sides, like the two party leaders, recorded one with Jeremy Corbyn, and Corbyn was promised that, you know, they were going to be doing a Boris Johnson interview, and then they just never did the Boris Johnson interview because the dude's just cowardly. Like, he literally hid in a fridge one time to avoid journalists who would give him lowball questions. So the BBC News Department has kind of, the rod from its own back, a saying like that, where they've done everything that they can to bend the knee, they've done everything they can to appease the current government, they will toe the party line, basically, for the Conservative Party. And I think over the past few years, they've been doing that out of fear that this would happen. However, what we need to understand with an authoritarian government like our current Conservative Party, and infamous clown Nadine Dorries, who we've talked about her before, literally does not know how Channel 4 is funded, even though she is in charge of the funding for Channel 4, or at least in charge of Channel 4 as the culture secretary, because it is still a government broadcaster, even though it's advertiser-funded. Yeah, and as Gherkin says, create a rod for their own back. Even though they towed the line as much as they could, they appeased this administration as much as they could, they were still seen as dispensable at the end of the day by this current government, who needs a scapegoat at the moment. We said earlier that Nadine Dorries, she did this announcement today in the House of Commons in Parliament. However, the Speaker actually told her off earlier on because she did this to the papers, because they need a scapegoat. There was even, I think, a newspaper that was even running the headline. I can't remember what it was this morning, that even the newspapers were like, yeah, this is obviously a scapegoat. This is obviously happening. High Vulture says, I don't think the scapegoat is working. I don't think it was either, because with the exception of some brain rot people on Twitter, you got a lot of support for the BBC and just defending it generally as an institution. What you have to ask with this current government is, what do they like about the UK? What do they like about the United Kingdom? Because it certainly isn't our NHS. It certainly isn't the BBC's cultural footprint, and it's high regard across the entire world, and it's celebrating its centenary this year as well. It's one of our greatest like cultural exports as well, and has launched the careers of some of like the most famous individuals on the planet. But they don't care about that either. They want it dismantled. And what I know some people with incredible brain rot will say is, like, why don't they just make it into a subscription service like Netflix? What you need to understand, though, is that massive streaming services like Netflix, like Amazon Video, operate at a loss. Netflix is not profitable. Amazon Video, or Amazon generally as a whole, is not profitable. You have, like, in the same way how in America they talk about the postal services, like, oh, the postal service operates at a loss every year, you need to shut it down. You kind of need to have that infrastructure there. It doesn't matter if it's at a loss, it's a service that people need. And I think that the BBC, in terms of their news department, have really, really let the side down, because for dramas and comedy and podcasts and audio and music has done an incredible job at launching so many British careers. But the news department has allowed this stigma around the BBC to arise over the past few years. You look at the BBC, you look at the hashtag defund the BBC campaigns on Twitter and the website, and I've gone through those tweets, I've gone through that website, and without fail, it's always about women and people of colour being on TV. I have never seen a defund the BBC argument not devolve to that level with minor pressing. It has never happened. Like, it is always about prominent marginalized people having a platform that these people hate about the BBC. And it's honestly as simple as that. There was the news story a couple of weeks ago about how the BBC posted that article about how, like, trans women are predators and, like, we're being forced into sex with trans women. Like, completely fabricated story with data in massive quotes sourced from an openly hostile transphobic outlet, right? It would be like me going to a Ku Klux Klan rally, okay? Me going to a Bolstrek comment section and saying, what do you think of black people? And then running that as a justified complaint on a news outlet. Like, obviously, you've cut that. That's the variable you've controlled for. You are obviously going to be getting a hostile reaction. It's not a proper site. It's not a proper, what do you call it? impartial poll or a good scientific or sociological poll. But the BBC ran that, and they keep doubling down on the mistruths that are in that article, as well as some objective stuff they've been called out on, including where the writer of that article was like, we reached out to many prominent trans people, but they didn't want to talk to us. Many people did interviews with them. Many people recorded those interviews. So they were just caught in outright lies. For Tom Schreck says, how many millions of pages of news has the BBC published over the past few years? However, despite an obvious, at best, centre-right-leaning platform for the BBC News Department, the organisation has a stigma about it being some massive, like, woke, loony, lefty institution, which is obviously, empirically not the case. Like, we have all of the data. The BBC over the past, like, 40 years has been vehemently anti-union. Like, they sided against the coal miners during, like, the Thatcher era. They sided with the police initially during Hillsborough, and they sided with our current government as well. And they don't defend themselves either. There was this as well. The BBC has said that cancel culture has no place on its airwaves and is ready to give a platform even to flat earth conspiracy theorists in its quest to broadcast a range of views. David Jordan, the BBC's director of editorial policy and standards, said that the corporation's impartiality rested on its commitment to freedom of speech and broadcasting opinions that some may find offensive, but saying that, yeah, we would broadcast flat earth conspiracy theories if we thought they were popular enough. And I forget who said the quote, maybe the chat will correct me on this, but who said the quote that as a journalist, if somebody comes to you, if a politician comes to you and says that it's raining outside and another politician says that it's not raining, it's not your job to remain impartial. It's your job to go to the window and check if it's fucking raining. And the BBC, as a basic duty to its like news outlets establishment, has utterly failed in this regard. It has utterly failed to call out right-wing politicians. It has utterly failed to fact-check basic stuff on the airwaves, and also platforming people like Nigel Farage. And it also shows when you platform people like Nigel Farage and you don't challenge them, that people of colour and immigrants and migrants from across Europe and across the rest of the world as well, that they are collateral damage in your war of appeasement. You are so desperate to appease these people, these charlatans, these liars, these open clowns, but you think that those marginalized groups are collateral damage for that. That their suffering, that their treatment in the rest of the world because of the people you've been platforming is okay because you can remain impartial. Impartiality in the current era is a pipe dream. You cannot be impartial when you have a government as anti-truth as this. You cannot be impartial when you have a government as anti-free speech as this. You can't do it. It's not good to platform others to sensationalize, but people like flat earthers should be allowed within debate so we can understand, not like that hurts people, just baffles them. No, but the BBC would basically bring on a flat earther and a non-flat earther and treat both sides as equal. That's the BBC's impartiality. Allegra Stratton was a BBC journalist for several years before moving on to the Conservative Party. There is a very clear pipeline from tabloids and even the BBC straight to government, and that pipeline is proving basically a threat to our democracy, because it means that you have these people who are so close to these journalistic institutions working in government. And let's not forget that Boris Johnson tried to sue Channel 4 because he was too cowardly to turn up to a Channel 4 leaders' climate debate. And Channel 4 pointed that out. And he wanted to shut down Channel 4 as a result. They are not here because they're worried about the BBC being a loony left institution. They want to shut down the BBC specifically because they do not like the headlines that they get on the 6 o'clock and the 10 o'clock news and on BBC Breakfast. And it's the only outlet they can specifically control and gut the funding of. That is literally the beginning and the end of it. What we get with the BBC, though, is that I understand that the BBC has done some terrible behaviour over the past few years. And I do understand that that is sort of like the minority, because they do so much stuff over like 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Like, and they've got quite a few terrible examples, like a single percentage, shall we say, of like terrible behaviour. But I think one reason why so many people get so invested and so upset about all of this stuff is because we kind of expect better from the BBC. Like, for example, like, for The Sun, like, we know that that's, like, a dedicated, like, fake news outlet, okay? But we also understand, like, GB News as well. And, like, I know people who work on, like, the production side of GB News, they know full well that they're working for a fake news organisation. It just pays really, really well. They know what they're getting into here. But for the BBC, it sort of has the air of, like, respectability, and they on paper strive to be respectable and impartial and true and holding power to account, but when we don't see them do it, that makes it all the more disappointing. But organizations like The Sun and GB News, they operate at a loss. Like The Sun, like the Rupert Murdoch paper in the UK, hasn't turned a profit for years. Like it operates at a loss because The Sun and Rupert Murdoch's empire is not about news. It is about shaping and shifting politics, and that's the name of the game here. When you see like Nadine Dorries like talking about how important the BBC is and how important media is and everything, I don't believe it for a single second, because let's not forget, and I will bang on about this until the end of my days, during the lockdowns and the pandemics, the freelancers and the PAYE workers working in the TV and film industry, including those at the BBC, got zero government support during those lockdowns when those TV productions were shuttered. They do not care at all about the cultural impact of the institution. They only see it as an enemy, and they see it as an enemy because it can speak. They see speech as the enemy, and that's why the BBC has got to go. And when you see people saying, oh, but I don't watch any of this stuff, I don't listen to the radio, I don't do the podcast, I don't use the iPlayer, why should I have to pay for it? Because in the same way how I have not stepped into a library for years, and I have never called the fire brigade, or like, you know, like I am working and like I'm able to work, so I don't need to get universal credit or anything, but I pay my taxes so that other people are able to, okay? I do not watch CBeebies. I do not watch CBBC. But I still think it is a cultural net good, and it helps families if my tax, if my license fee makes sure that someone's kid does have entertainment, is able to watch something or get education. At the beginning of the pandemic, when many schools were shut, BBC and BBC Bite Size, which is their educational branch, were doing broadcasts and special, like, Jodie Whittaker did one, did like a science, she hosted a science segment as well, talking about, like, they did lessons from home while kids were unable to attend schools. Like, you're not going to get that from a Netflix. You're not going to get that from a Netflix. And also, it was very, very funny. This was ages ago, but it was very, very funny seeing people say, oh, Doctor Who should be cancelled and they should put it on Netflix. And then they immediately shifted tact when Netflix released Cuties. And they were like, okay, this culture war narrative has served its purpose. We're going to completely forget about that now. We've gone over the viewing figures as well, generally, but it's all like BBC stuff and also ITV and Channel 4, of course, but the BBC is like the most viewed media in this country as well. It eclipses Netflix, it eclipses Amazon Video, it eclipses BritBox, even though BritBox is partially owned by the BBC and ITV's commercial divisions, and also eclipses Disney Plus as well. Yeah, and for, what, 40p a day, we get all of that good stuff. And many people want to see it shut down because there's women and people of colour involved. And also because even though BBC News doesn't, they are worried that BBC News might say bad things about the government. They just want a scapegoat at the moment. But remember, Nadine Dorries did not know how Channel 4 was funded, even though she's in charge of it. Tory MP Nick Fletcher, who we've talked about before, said that women being involved in media, appearing on TV and film, caused men to commit crimes, including but not limited to stabbings. And Boris Johnson wanted to sue Channel 4 because they accurately pointed out his behaviour. These people, this government, should not be in charge of our media. They are not fit for purpose to do so. When you look at, and this is of course a tweet here as well, when you look at the behaviour of the news outlets as well, like this was like an actual genuine screenshot from the 2019 general election, Jeremy Corbyn with a Stalin's Russia backdrop and everything here, while also simultaneously running stories talking about talking about Jeremy Corbyn being anti-Semitic without any sort of like evidence or anything like that, but also simultaneously running stories about Boris Johnson and failing to mention his frequent anti-Semitism, including but not limited to a 2019 campaign video which aired on the BBC and was shown on BBC iPlayer, where Boris Johnson was basically saying, "Don't vote for Jeremy Corbyn or the Jews will take over." The hypocrisy was astounding. But yeah, talking about Question Time, would you nationalise sausages? Like, crazy, crazy platforming stuff on BBC Question Time. Painting Rishi Sunak literally as Superman on the news, even though Rishi Sunak, in a BBC interview, has demonstrated he literally does not know how the economy functions. And also, calling it communism when Jeremy Corbyn and the Labour Party was talking about having broadband be accessible for all as a general election, like, campaign pledge. It's a rod for its own back, and the BBC did everything it could in 2019 to ensure that this current government that wants to dismantle it got in power. Was it worth it? Now, I will defend the BBC as an idea, as something that I think culturally, in terms of its drama, its comedy for the most part, like Little Britain, you know, Water Under the Bridge, and in terms of its how many careers it's launched for BBC Music, how BBC Radio is important, and CBeebies and CBBC, and the iPlayer as well, I think that's incredibly important and needs keeping. However, I think that, in the future, the BBC needs drastic leadership reform. When you do have somebody just openly lying on the airwaves, you do need a system in place to be able to fact check them on the fly. They need to cut anybody out of that institution who thinks that platforming flat earthers are okay. Anyone who is complicit with posting lies about trans people or black people or people of colour or the marginalised groups, they need gutting as well. As in gutting from the institution, not literally gutting. I don't call for violence. And also, anyone who has used the BBC as a CV booster to get a role in government, like Allegra Stratton, they need outing as well. They need removing from their positions. The BBC is a great idea, and I love its cultural impact, but its news division and its general leadership as well needs drastic reform. However, when people talk about BBC dramas and stuff being woke and stuff, they are specifically only talking about casting, only talking about people of colour, not actual, like, political ideology or anything like that. It is just people who are being very, very upset that black people are on their TV screen. I've talked about this before. Like, even, like, John Tarrow talking in the chat earlier, like, that was the only thing he could talk about when, like, why Doctor Who was woke. It's a slightly depressing scenario. However, I think what somebody in the chat was saying earlier about how I think this sort of media scapegoat and this diversion has not really worked because people are just using it as an excuse to talk about how much they enjoy and like the BBC. The license fee is going to be frozen for the next few years, and the plan is that the license fee would be abolished from 2027 to 2028 onwards. However, we have an institution, the BBC, with a approval rating and polling and stuff in the high 90s, like the mid to high 90%. Whereas our current Conservative government have approval ratings polling at around the 20 to 25% range. So, yeah, but although, you know, that hasn't tried to stop them from going for the NHS as well. There will hopefully be an election in the next couple of years, like 2 or 3 years' time, that would be, what, 2024, 2025? And hopefully if the Conservative Party is outed then, or if there's like a hung parliament or a coalition government that does not involve the Conservatives, then that actually means that these plans can be changed. But I've not seen many people on the Labour side who, for those of you who don't know, currently are like centre, like borderline centre-right party at the moment, led by Keir Starmer. So I've not really seen many of them come to the BBC's defence at the moment. It is possible that, depending on the results of the next election, that these plans change. But I also think that the BBC, hopefully now, with this, is a wake-up call to them to know that despite how much of the boot they've been licking, how much of their back they've been bending, how much they've been trying to appease and suck up to this current government that has shown nothing but open hostility and contempt for them. I hope that this now is a wake-up call to them, and that they will use the centenary and the upcoming years to make their case. And also, folks, if any of you as well watching this, if you see somebody like, say, or the BBC loony left organisation, just ask them, what are you on about? Like, ask them to name the specifics. Because I also, like, we've even done it over the course of this live stream. These narratives falter under basic follow-up questions. Because like I said, I've been sort of like following the defund the BBC campaigns over the past few years. And with those basic follow-up questions, it completely like just descends to, oh, we hate people of colour. Oh, we hate women. We hate media that shows Jewish people. We hate people. We hate media that shows Muslim people, etc., etc. That's just what it all comes down to, basically. It is identity politics. The BBC, in the eyes of this current Conservative government, are just another bullet in the chamber for their culture war. That's all it is at the end of the day for them. And I hope the BBC use their centenary year to just, for the first time, at least in my lifetime, defend itself. Make a case for itself. Because if you, like, do you really want to be the 100-year-old institution that was brought down because Boris Johnson wanted people to stop talking about all the parties he held? Do you want that to be your fate? Like, grow a spine. Grow a spine. Stick up for yourself. I also think that in future as well, providing, like, once if it is able to survive for the next 10 years, I do think that the whoever's in charge, hopefully Labour, or the Green Party, or whatever, like, left, in quotes, party is able to take over in the near future, are able to make, like, have some defense mechanisms in place, like, legally, in law, to defend the BBC. That means that its prices, that its license fee will match inflation, which means that, you know, that it's actually, they're contractually obligated, like, politicians, to have interviews with the BBC when called. I don't know how you'd enforce that, but like the whole Andrew Neil thing with Boris Johnson as well, like how he was able to avoid scrutiny up until the election. Like, there needs to be something like written down in law that no, you can't do that. No, you can't do that. So in order to make the BBC what we know it can be and has sometimes proven itself to be, but for the past 30 to 40 years, it has, at least as a, like a, its news division, has been at best a centre-right organisation. And that fundamentally needs to change, because we've seen the polling, we've seen the stats, that the majority of people in this country are left or centre-left. That's just what the polling shows. And we need a BBC that represents them. Not only because, you know, you deserve the representation in the media, but also because the people on the left will be the ones who will have your back. They will be the ones who will defend your freedom of speech, will defend a publicly funded broadcaster, whereas the opposition will do everything they can to dismantle you. And I hope that at this time, in early 2022, with the BBC just showing open contempt for people of colour, for Jewish communities, for Muslim communities, for the LGBTQ plus communities and stuff, and I hope that, like, hopefully not too much damage has been done to those communities. Like, I don't see, like, I see many trans people, of course, like, saying, like, you know, the BBC deserve this treatment. And I think, obviously, the BBC have done reprehensible stuff to that community. Absolutely have. Like, deplorable behaviour. That people, heads should roll at that organisation for the treatment there. For the, just outright lies and fabrications. Like, absolutely. That should happen. It would have to be like a, the enemy of my enemy is my friend, but I understand many communities do not have the patience for that. Like their pity well is as dried out. Okay, I get it absolutely, and I can't even tell them that they're wrong for thinking that. ST says don't want the future of TV to be completely streaming. Yeah. Also, one thing that the BBC license fee does pay for is the maintaining and the upkeeping of Freeview as well. Like, just allowing other channels to broadcast. Like, that needs to be funded somehow. The license fee goes towards that as well. Kisa Hussein, did you talk about how this would affect Doctor Who series 14? honestly, I think Doctor Who is safe because it is still, despite what people say, one of the most viewed shows on the BBC. It is one of the only shows that broadcasts regularly on the BBC that has a international cultural stamp. Like, it's broadcast all across the world. So yeah, I think Doctor Who is safe, but I think just funding generally go down across the board. I do think that because of austerity and stuff and cuts and everything for the past 10 years, that the days of a 13 episode series are over. WG Fans says, and it's supported by Sony. Creatively, or I think maybe with international distribution, but I still think that the BBC and also at Time Lord, Strictly, Doctor Who, Top Gear, they're all not going anywhere. But for Doctor Who, they'll take the budget, they'll take the brick out the wall, give it to Bad Wolf or Sony, and then that's it. That will be the transactional thing. The infamous words of Russell T. Davis predicting exactly this thing would happen.
We are heading towards what the government wants and what is going to happen, because I honestly think this battle has been lost, is we're heading towards some sort of subscriber service. And where the mistake then is made is that everyone, and this was in like the Radio Times letter page when you started this debate, and there were people on that letters page saying, why don't we have a subscriber service like HBO? Like HBO, one of the finest broadcasters in the world. Why do I will pay my subscription fee. I will join in with HBO. That is what I'll get. People in this country have no idea what HBO is or what it means. And I spent the past few days going through the website. And I went ahead. I have to look at my phone to get some details. But on a week on HBO, so you've got seven channels: HBO, HBO 2, HBO Signature, HBO Family, HBO Comedy, HBO Zone, HBO Latino. Doesn't that sound marvellous? You pay for that $15 a month, which is $180 a year, which equals like £118. So it's cheaper than the license fee. We think that's brilliant. What you get is no news, no news, no voice, no soap opera, no weather, no radio stations, Radio 1, Radio 2, Radio 4, nothing like that. All you get are these seven channels. This is what you get in this week. And bear in mind that this is in October, so it's like the sort of prime time. You get, on a Saturday, you get a two-hour film, which you might have seen already, called Focus, not a very good film, 14 minutes of boxing. 14 minutes 14. Of boxing. On a Sunday night is good, you get 2.5 hours of original programs, including The Leftovers, which is a great drama, Doll and M. Monday night, nothing. Nothing new at all. On Tuesday night, nothing. Nothing new at all. No new programs, no news broadcasts, no magazine programs, no Phil and Holly. This is what I'm telling you. You pay a full subscription fee, which is practically the price of a license fee. You get nothing. People in this country say we should have a subscriber service like HBO because it's the finest broadcaster in the world. It gives you nothing. All right, you get Game of Thrones. You get that for 10 weeks of the year, 1 hour a week. 10 weeks of the year, that's all you get. We are being led towards a subscriber service which you are being told is marvellous, and it's a lie. It gives you a couple of hours of good drama a week and nothing else. And that, in 10 years' time, is what they will demand the BBC becomes. And it is a disgrace.
Yeah, he's a smart dude. He's a smart dude. We got George in the chat. A lot of the BBC is reruns. To be fair, that's because the production pipeline over the past year, year and a half, has been hurt because of lockdowns and COVID and stuff like that, because of restrictions, meaning that a lot of stuff could not be filmed.